Now, good morning everyone. Now in the previous lectures, that models that we have developed are described by linear time invariant differential equations. That is, the models that we have discussed are the linear time invariant differential equation, that is LTI. However, you can see that there are non-linearities in the system. So, non-linearities. So, there are non-linearities in the system. So, how that non-linearities can be handled? So, first we define the term that is linear and non-linear. And after that, we will how to distinguish between the linear and non-linear system, and then we can discuss that how this linear approximation of the non-linear system can be obtained to use these modeling techniques in that. Now, for the term to be linear, the two properties needs to be satisfied. One property is the superposition, and other property is the homogeneity. This superposition and homogeneity, these you have already read in your mathematics class, that how the system is linear and how the system is non-linear. So if the system is linear, then it follows these two properties, that is superposition and the homogeneity. It means that if, let us suppose that we have the input R1T, we have the input R1T, and it yields an output, that is C1T. And let us suppose that we have the input R2T, which yields the output as C2T. Then if the input is the sum of the two, that is R1T plus R2T, then the response would also be the sum of the two, that is C1T plus C2T. So this is the superposition. That is, we have the two inputs and two outputs. If we add these two inputs, then the response would be the addition of these outputs. So this is what is superposition is all about. Now come to homogeneity. In case of the homogeneity, let us suppose that we have the input R1T, which yields the output as C1T, and let us suppose that we multiply the input by some scalar, let us suppose A. We multiply the input by some scalar, let us suppose A in this case, then the output is also multiplied by A. It means that suppose input is AR1T, then the output is also equals to AC1T. Now it means that the multiplication of an input by a scalar A yields a response that is multiplied by the same scalar, that is A in this case. So if these two properties, that superposition and homogeneity, are satisfied, then we can say that the system is linear system. Now this can be explained one with simple example. Let us suppose that we have one system whose graph is represented by this input-output graph, and in that case the input is on the this x, that is x-axis, and output is on y-axis, that is fx. So the relationship between input and output is, in this case, is as we have seen here, is fx is equal to 0.5x. So it is the relationship between the input and the output. Now we test these two properties, that is superposition and homogeneity, in this. Now let us suppose if the input is 1, if the input is 1, then the output is 0.5 in this case, as it is observed. If the input is 2, then the output is 1 point, that is output is 1 here, 2, output is 1 in this case. Now if we add these two, that is if the input is 3, then output in this case is 1.5. so it means that it remains same. So this is the that superposition theorem can be valid in this case, that is if the input is 1, the output is 0.5, input is 2, the output is 1, then we take as the sum of the two inputs, 1 plus 2 is 3, and we get the whatever the relation we got in the previous case. So as a result, as the superposition, it passed the superposition theorem. Now we will discuss the homogeneity theorem in this case. Now what was the homogeneity theorem? That is, we have this, let us suppose that we have the input as R1T and output is as C1T. So we multiply A, then in output it is also multiplied by A. Let us suppose that at the input we have 1, and at the output we are getting corresponding to n as 0.5. Now what we do, we multiply the input by 2. Let us suppose scalar 2, we will take A as 2, 2 into 1. So in the output also it is multiplied, that is 2 into 0.1, that is we see that corresponding to 2 we have 1 here. It means that if it is 2, then we get 1 in this case, that corresponding to 2 we have 1. Now take another example. Let us suppose that in this case the R1 is 2 and the output that we are getting is 1. Now if the input is multiplied by, let us suppose, scalar A as 2, then the input in this case is 4, and as a result output we should get 2. So we multiply 2 into 2, 1 into 2, that is if the input is 4, then the output should be 2. So we can see that the homogeneity property has also been satisfied in this case. So the system whose response is like that is linear in nature. However, if the input output relationship would be like that, definitely from this curve you can see it is non-linear in nature, because from this seeing only we can observe that it doesn't follow these property of superposition as well as the homogeneity. Now we will discuss some of the examples of physical non-linearities. Now first case, we will have this amplifier. In the first case we have the amplifier saturation, And the second case is the this can be this is represented by this input output curve, that is amplifier saturation, like that. So on x-axis we will have the input, and on the y-axis we will have the output. This is an example of amplifier saturation, that is the amplifier is linear over a specific range but exhibits a non-linearity called saturation at high values of the input, that is at the high values of the voltage it exhibits the non-linearity. So this is an example of the amplifier. Now second we will discuss, now this is the motor dead zone, that is a motor does not respond at a very low input voltage due to the frictional forces exhibits and due to the frictional forces and it exhibits a non-linearity, which is known as the dead zone. And the third example is a backlash in the gears. It means that if the gears that do not fit tightly exhibit a non-linearity, which is known as the backlash. That is, the input moves over a small range without the output responding. Now, another example is the phase-locked loop, which is found in the FM radio receiver, whose output response is the sine of the input. So it is also non-linear. Now from the designer point of view, if we are designing this, from the designer point of view, a designer often make a linear approximation of non-linear system. Now the linear approximation simplify the analysis and design of the system and are used as long as the results yield a good approximation, that is, which is approximate to the reality. For example, a linear relationship can be established at a point on the non-linear curve if the range of input values about that point is small and origin is translated to that point. So we consider that point as linear to some range. Now its finest example is the electronic amplifier that perform linear amplification with small excursion about a point. Now the electrical mechanical system that we have considered so far, these are assumed to be linear. So if the non-linear components are present, then we must linearize these non-linear components. That is, we must linearize the system before we find the transfer function. Now the first point related with that, to linearize that, is to write the differential equation, that is, recognize the non-linear component and then write the differential equation. When we linearize a non-linear differential equation, we linearize it for a small signal input about the steady state solution when the small signal input is equal to zero. This steady state solution is called the equilibrium and is the second step in the linearization process. The first is we write the differential equation. Second, we for a small signal inputs about the steady state solution, we linearize it, and this point is known as the equilibrium point. For example, let us take the case of a pendulum. Now let us take the case of a pendulum. It is at rest. It means that it is at equilibrium. Now the angular displacement is described by the non-linear differential equation. The angular displacement of this pendulum can be described by the non-linear differential equation. However, it can be expressed with the linear differential equation if the excursion of these pendulum is very small about that equilibrium point. Suppose we are considering that excursion would be very small, then we can express it as the linear differential equation. So this is the point. So the second step is the linearization of nonlinear differential equation, and then we take the Laplace. Then we find the Laplace transform of linearized differential equation by assuming the zero initial condition. And finally, in the similar way, we separate input and the output variables and form a transfer function. So this is way how we can do write in differential equation, form, then linearize about the small point, and then find out the Laplace transform of that while assuming the zero initial condition, and then represent it into input output form. Now let us take an example. Let us assume a nonlinear system operating at a point A. That is, in this case, let A be the operating point, and which is x and y at that operating point is, that is, x naught and f of x naught. Okay. Now, small changes in input can be related to the small changes in the output about the point by the way of slope of the curve at the this slope of the curve at this A. Okay. Now let us suppose that the slope of the curve at this point A is MA. Then small excursions of the input about point A, let us suppose small excursions of the input about point A is del x. It will yield the small changes in the output, that is del f x at point A. That is, if the input at point A is del x, then output at point A is del f x, and which is related by the slope at the point A. So we can write, in terms of slope, we can write f x minus f x naught is approximately equals to slope m A into x minus x naught. Now, as we have discussed that this change is only a very small change, so it is del f x, and this is approximately del x, and also f x is approximately f x naught plus m a x minus x naught, which is approximately equal to f x naught plus m a del x. So this can be explained graphically, that a new axis is generated, that is del fx, which is clear from this equation, and del fx and del x. So a new set of axes is created at the point A. Okay, and is approximately equal to fx xx naught, approximately equals to fx naught, the ordinate of the new origin plus small excursions that ma del x away from the point A. So in this way we have to do the linearization. We take a nonlinear curve, linearize at the point A, and finally we are getting another set of axes which is linear for a small change only. So this is about the nonlinearities, how to linearize it. Generally we are doing the Taylor series expansion for the linearization and neglecting the higher order terms for the linearization in the this generally electrical systems. Now we can find the linear linearization process. It is very helpful for seeing any response of the system or to solve any system, and to apply the Laplace transform we need the these linear systems, and if the non-linear systems are there then we convert it into linear about the equilibrium point. In the electrical network, let us suppose that if the system is there having a non-linear resistor, then we apply first apply the Kirchhoff's voltage law in that, and after that we can linearize that. Before that we will find a equilibrium point. Generally equilibrium point can be found out by keeping the voltage as equals to zero and find the equilibrium point and linearize these equation and find the result. So in this way linearization can be done in all the systems, even in the electrical and the mechanical system. So any non-linear system can be converted into the linear system for a small range. So in this lecture you have read about the different aspects of linearity, and hope you understand well. And we can start with some other topic in the next lecture. Thank you very much.